recycling, and we were asked to be a part of the carpet recycling group because we recycle construction and demolition debris. We're in Palatine, Illinois, and we're just one of the C&D folks who are on the group. We're trying to get as many as we can. So we started with, I'll just tell you a little bit about what we do though. We recycle, like I said, construction and demolition debris. Walter said we've been doing it for a little over 10 years. And with that, we've always gotten carpet in our loads because a lot of what we get in is either a remodel or a demolition or, you know, things of that nature, and it's always commingled. So, you know, it comes into us with all the other debris as well, you know. We have a facility there that's, you know, partially automated, and we do hand sorting as well. We recycle about 75% on average, and a little bit more if it's the newer construction. You know, it's a little difficult sometimes. Depends on what you get in each load, depending on where the demolition is coming from. But I'm just going to briefly just show you a few pictures of our facility. As you can see, there's where all the lines are, where all the people are working and pulling out all the different commodities. Again, we also have our own roll-offs. We do have a provided roll-off service where we can pick up. Let me just tell you, this is a little bit of everything that comes out of our loads, okay? As you can imagine, being all construction debris, and now we are proud to say, and we just added that to our website, that we can recycle carpet. Because before that, all of it was going to the landfill. All these big heavy bundles that we would get in. And something new too that we're recycling is vinyl siding, we have plastic, and asphalt shingles we do. Pretty much a little bit of everything. Okay, so here's like a little picture just to show you we get them in different kinds of boats. We can have like a small individual person coming in who, you know, may be doing the carpet project, but it looks like he's got some other stuff in there as well. And then a complete roll-off, a big roll-off truck, because we get a lot of third-party customers as well dumping at our site, not just our own trucks. And as you can see, that's got everything mixing with it. Okay. Here's just a picture of our truck in one of our boxes. We have all different sizes that we can offer customers. And we go out to their job sites and provide the box and then come pick it up when it's ready and bring it back to our facility to recycle. We work a lot with general contractors who want to build green, so we can provide them with monthly lead documentation. We grade all their loads and we give them, like I said, monthly reports, and then that way they can, you know, earn points towards the sustainability rating of, you know, USGBC. That's huge. That's been a big thing. So it's kind of nice now that we can add the carpet and get even more recycled out of those loads and more points for everyone. Again, just like here's another picture of, you know, it's not pretty, right? When the carpet comes in, it's mixed, you know, it's not just typically clean carpet or anything that we can just literally put in one pile. We have to sort through it and pull it apart and then put it in a container so it can be ready to be hauled off. Again, we're thrilled because Heritage Recycling approached us, and they came to us and asked us if we wanted to be part of the program, and we jumped right on board with this. It was, you know, easy for us to say yes. There is a cost involved, because I know someone was asking. We unfortunately, obviously, we have to charge for people to dump at our facility, or we have to charge them if we don't pick it up in one of our boxes, only because we have processing costs and, you know, you can see labor, it's labor intensified as well. And then we have a dump fee when we go to Heritage, you know, because of the transportation. And they charge us to dump there as well. So, it's been a little bit of a problem. Not so much when it comes commingled like this. It's easy. All of the construction debris comes to our place, and these are the easy loads. But what we've had a difficult time with is our salesmen trying to promote, go out there and promote like installers or carpet manufacturers, like, you know, local stores that sell carpets. He's been, maybe go to the next one. Did I put that on the chat? Okay, I just wanted to show how we then load it. When we're finally ready and we have a nice load for Heritage, we will then load it on the big, you know, walking floor trailers and get about like 21, 22 tons. And, you know, we've been trying it. It's been difficult. You've got to get the right container. But you can get about 21 tons in there. And then off it goes to their facility. Let's show the next thing. Our salesman has been going around, and they kind of, Heritage was nice enough to give us like a little slip sheet here, a flyer. And he's been leading those. They've been very receptive. Carpet manufacturers, well, not the manufacturers, but like I said, the local stores that sell the carpet. They have been letting him lead these flyers for the installers. And actually, as soon as he says the word recycling, that's what's grabbed their attention, okay? So he gets them there, and they're very receptive, and they want to do the right thing. But then a lot of them, actually more than once, they've asked him, so how much will you pay us to go for the carpet, you know? And again, they don't understand that we have, you know, costs associated with it, so we can't pay them, they have to actually pay us. I like what you did, Jim, because I thought the same thing. Palatine's a big community, and you know, we also have Arlington Heights and Rolling Meadows around us. I was thinking the same thing. We could provide like the container, and we would deliver for free and pick up for free, and then maybe we could work with Heritage and work out some kind of cost thing, or the village would actually contribute to or something. We could have like a one-day collection event. I was thinking about that. I wanted to talk to them about that, and I'm glad that did work, see? I didn't know if it would, because you never know if people want to actually store carpet at their house. Like you were saying, you know, it could be dirty or whatever, and then take the time to load it in their car and kind of like shove it over, right? But I guess they do, right?
I think they do. I think that people store it. Isn't that nice? I don't know what to do with it, but they want to do
it. Yep, sorry, I need the readers here. But see, here's the thing. Our salesman, like I said, he's been contacting the installers, the carpet suppliers, and he's provided the, you know, flyers, and they get the need of the recycling. They love that. That gets their attention. But here's a couple of the downsides. The installers want to always pass through the cost to the customer. They don't want to incur any extra costs. So what they told them is they literally will cut it up and just roll it down to the curb and leave it there for the customers to have their curbside, you know, waste hauler pick it up and dispose of it that way. That's the biggest thing. That's where we're missing out on all this carpet, because then it just obviously going to go to the landfill. You know, so he's really having a tough connection with that. And the other thing is, what was I going to say? We recently, when we had all the flooding, okay, so sure, everyone, we just got an influx of carpet, but it was all wet. I mean, and you guys can't tap it and recycle it when it's drenched. So that was kind of a problem too. Here we got a bunch of carpet and we were all excited, and yet we couldn't even transfer it over to your facility because it wasn't going to work. You know, Bill didn't come out and take a look at it. It wasn't in the right condition. And so he was excited, Henry, our salesman, because he's had a couple of calls, his first calls for people who have ordered a roll-off container, a big one, to put just carpet in, okay? And one is a local carpet store, and they're going to put it behind their store, and then they're going to have all their, you know, installers come back and be able to have it like a drop-off. So we're thrilled, but we have to see in what condition we're going to get that back, because now it's outside, and we don't have closed tops. We've provided them a tarp, but again, you're at their mercy. You're asking people, you know, do something, you know, and make sure that they cover it and, you know, kind of keep their eye on it and so that it comes back to us in good shape. But we'll see, you know. Actually, there's two boxes out right now, so I was hoping one would have came back before then, but no, he's confident. He's kind of excited. He's got a good reception so far, and I just hope that he can get, you know, more people on board and we can get the garden for these folks. You know, I saw some names on there that were missing, but we do have some other friends in the business, in the C&D world, who just didn't make the list. I kept telling them to send their information in to Jennifer, and they didn't, but they are collecting carpet. So yeah, there's one down in the little cook area, so we're covering all different, you know, spots. And you know, what else can I say? Is there any questions, sir?
Any questions for Wendy? I mean, I think it's great what you're saying, people getting out and actually networking out and getting the word out. I mean, that's so powerful.
After it gets wet, could you possibly dry it out, like lay it out and dry it out, or what is the problem?
The problem with the polypropylene is a hydrophobic, so you can process polypropylene. Just once you, all the water will stay in training with the calcium carbonate. But the problem is that she's got a whole load of mix. We don't know what it is until it's received in Kansas City or possibly next facility where he shears carpet. So we potentially have just hauled an entire truckload of nylon fibers to our facility that water gets entrained in and stays in our product throughout. There's a certain moisture content that is allowable by the next step in the recycling process. And if it's over generally 2% moisture, we've made a bad product. So we spent a lot of money to haul it all the way to Kansas City. We spent a lot of money to run it through our huge operation, and now we have a product on the back end that we are struggling to sell.
I think at that scale, you can't roll it out and put it dry.
Right. Well, I did advise my friend. We have a facility in expense is hauling the materials to our facilities.
Like Steve?
I think she just answered my question, but Wendy, do you do any sorting of carpet, or do you just put it all in a container and all goes to?
We do, because Steve, we had talked about that when they approached us, and there's some devices that can.
Yeah, they're infrared guns, and they cost, and this is another entry, this is going to be a problem with carpet recycling. These things cost per gun somewhere between $18,000 to $25,000.
Plus, what she was saying about the carpet was wet, so these guns shoot a laser into it, they have kickback in the fiber type. When the carpet's wet, you know, you're hitting that water, and that laser diffracts, and it didn't work. So that's probably, you know, transportation kills us too, but that's the other way things have happened.
So those guns, you need at least three of them, you know, because they are not, they're not that, we're constantly sending our guns back into the manufacturer to repair them. So you have to have a whole lot on hands, and that costs a lot, but we would never expect, you know, an operation like a CMB facility is, you go in them, they're pretty, I want to say manual, but you do not want to drop one of these on a conveyor and a, you know, a piece of equipment because it's just too much money and capital with these. So we kind of want to be responsible. Like, we do not want to be responsible for these guns.
So at least they take everything, which is nice.
So we do it at our facilities. And I think Nick does the same with your operation as well.
My mind is on the one that I read on my flipbook just for this.
Did you?
Does your cost, I mean, I don't want to put this disclaimer or anything, but your cost similar than these boxes as a typical roll-off? Okay, so in other words, they don't really have a big excuse to say, well, no, we can't do it because it's too much.
Oh, no, not at all. Because you're right, Dave. It's right in line with the pricing that we have. It's an identical actually. We do charge the same as we do to take in construction debris.
Yeah.
Because it's still the same kind of process. And the dumping fees for us are similar to, you know, where we have to either haul something that's recyclable to an end market. We have to pay that all, you know, normally. And there's plenty of stuff that leaves our facility that we have to pay, like the 25% that we don't recycle.
Right.
We have to pay for the hauling and the dump fees and the landfill stuff, you know. So we have all those costs. So it's the same. We just charge them our regular pay rate. And, you know,
that's,
they've been fine with that,
because
it is missed.
Sure, and the panning is recyclable
all the time. Yeah, right.
You might forget the flat, too?
See, yeah, Dr. Sam, he says, the padding thing's one